Good day, students. Today we'll be discussing about systems and its properties. So first, what is called as a system? In the previous classes, you have discussed about continuous time signals as well as discrete time signals, right? If the signal processed, continuous time signals are processed on continuous time systems. Discrete time signals are processed on discrete time systems, right? To understand how a continuous time has to be converted into discrete time and why it should be done, it will be covered in sampling in the next unit. So first, let us try to understand what is called or what is the relationship between the inputs and outputs and the impulse response in a continuous time system. So it is given here that to the system which is characterized by its impulse response h of t, if the input to the system is x of t, then the output is called, then the output of the system is y of t. Here, x of t is the input, y of t is the output, and h of t is called as the impulse response. The relationship between the input, output, and the impulse response of a continuous time system is given by y of t equal to x of t convolution with h of t. The meaning of convolution will be covered in unit 2 when we discuss in detail. Now, what is called as impulse response, right? So here we have seen that h of t is called as impulse response. So what is impulse response? Impulse response h of t is nothing but the output of the same system when the input applied to the system is an impulse input. You know very well what is called as an impulse input, right? You would have studied in signals. So when this impulse input is applied to the system, the corresponding output what you get is called as impulse response h of t. This h of t is used to characterize the system under our consideration, which is given as h of t, right? Extending the same fact into discrete time system, a discrete time system accepts an input x of n on its impulse response h of n and produces output y of n. X of n is the input, y of n is the output, and h of n is the impulse response. The relationship between output, input, and impulse response of discrete holds the same. Y of n equal to x of n convolution with h of n. So for a discrete time system, the impulse response h of n is nothing but the output of the system when the input applied to the system is an impulse input. So this is the fundamental overview of what is called as a system. Proceeding on, we are going to discuss about the various properties that can be applied on a system. So henceforth, we will proceed on to the properties. The first property under consideration is causality property, and the systems are classified as causal and non-causal system. What is called as causal system? A causal system is one in which the output at any time t depends on present and past inputs but not on future input, right? It is a meaning that if I need to evaluate any output at current time t, right, that will depend only on the present and the past values, but definitely it will not depend on future values. Such type of system is called as causal system. It is also called as non-anticipative system because we will not be able to predict what is the future, right? We will not be able to predict the output based on the future values of the system. Hence, it is called as non-anticipative system. In contrast, non-causal systems are systems at which the output at any time t depends only on the future values of the input, right? It does not depends only, it depends on future values of the input, right? So if I need to calculate output at any time, that current output might be dependent on present, past, or in sometimes it will also depend on future also. In that case, that type of system is called as non-causal system. One example that is being shown for a non-causal system, to just get in detail about what is called as non-causal. Imagine that you have to write an exam without a question paper, right? Right? You have to write a current exam based on a question paper that will be given to you after half an hour, right? Is it possible to realize a system like that? No, right? So non-causal system, it is not physically realizable, right? Non-causal system is not practically or physically realizable. So why does it occur? Right? As you proceed on, you will be seeing that when you design systems, analytically, there will be conditions where non-causality conditions will be arising, right? However, this non-causal conditions have to be eradicated by converting the systems into causal system. Let us not go much into detail about it. As far as now, we will discuss about how you can classify the system as a causal or non-causal system. So, problem, check for causality of the following system. Before doing the problem, the preliminary procedure that has to be followed for checking causality is, you have to check for three conditions. That is, for any time, for positive, negative and zero values, right? For all these three cases, positive, negative and at time t equal to zero, you have to check for the system, right? So the first problem is, we have taken a continuous time system. So you can see that the input is x of t minus 1. It is acting on the system, which produces an output y of t, right? So now I have to substitute the values of t for positive, negative and zero, right? So, for t equal to 0, so what happens for t equal to 0 when you substitute y of 0? Y of 0 is equal to x of 0 plus x of minus 1. It is obvious that output at time t equal to 0 is dependent on input at time t equal to 0, which is output depends on present time, right? And at the same time, output at time t equal to 0 is dependent on past values of the input, because minus 1 is past when compared with 0, right? You should be a little bit clear about this point. So if you take an axis like this, right, your time axis, when you take your time axis, you have here 0, 1, 2, right? Minus 1, minus 2, right? So when you take this here, 1 is future when compared with 0. 2 is future when compared with 0 and 1, right? And then 0 is past when compared with 1 and 2. So in this case, you should know. Similarly, minus 1 is past when compared with 0. Minus 2 is again past when compared with minus 1 and 0, right? So you should understand this. So based on this now, you can see that in this current scenario, output at time t equal to 0 is present on is dependent on present and the past values of input, right? So next you have to consider for a positive value of t. It is not necessary you should take only one. You can also take 2 or 3 or any value. So you can see that output at time instant t equal to 1 is dependent on current value of input 1, right? Then similarly, output at time t equal to 1 is dependent on x of 0, which is past with respect to 1, right? So third case, we are taking a negative value. So when we take t equal to minus 1, we can see that y of minus 1 equal to x of minus 1 plus, if you substitute t equal to minus 1, you will be getting x of minus 2. So y of minus 1 is dependent on present as well as past values of input, right? Hence, in these three cases, we observe that output at any time is not dependent on the future values. Hence, the system is said to be causal system, right? Moving on to the next one. Y of n is equal to x of 2n. Same procedure, you just need to analyze. Just you can put a pause on the video and try it by yourself. The hint is you have to apply. So here we have taken discrete time system. Previous problem was continuous time. This one is discrete time. However, the procedure is same. You have to check for three conditions, positive, zero, as well as negative, right? Just pause your video and try it on by yourself. So now, just you can verify. So for when I'm taking n equal to 0, y of 0 equal to x of 0. It means that output at any time, at current time, y of 0 is present on current value of input x of 0, right? Next, we are going to take positive value, n equal to 1. So you can observe that y of 1 is dependent on x of 2. You can see here that 2 is future when compared with 1. That means output at time 1 is dependent on future values of the input. Hence, the system is said to be non-causal system. It is not necessary for me to go to another negative value, because in positive value itself, I'm getting, right? Even in one case, if output is dependent on future, you can classify it as a non-causal system. So the output y of n depends on future values of x of n. This system is called as non-causal system. Third one, y of n is equal to x of n plus 1 by x of n minus 1. Whenever a question is given, you can just put a pause, try to think about it, and then proceed on with the video. So same procedure for n equal to 0, it is dependent on present and the past values of the input. For positive values, again, it is dependent on, output is dependent on present values of input and past values of input. Third, for n, actually, the thing is here it should be, small correction, here it should be n equal to minus 1 negative value, and this is going to be n equal to plus 1, right? So for n equal to plus 1, y of 1 equal to x of 1 plus 1 by x of 0. So output is dependent on present values and past values. So in all three cases, the output at any time n is not dependent on the future values. Hence, the system, it depends only on present and past values. Hence, the system is said to be a causal system. Right? Then, moving, I think the causality property is clear. Now we'll move on to the next property or next type of system, linear and a nonlinear system. And the corresponding property is called as linearity property. Before going into how to classify it as a linear or nonlinear, let us just understand what is called as a linear and nonlinear from a very broad perspective. Right? So just look here, I have given a system equation y of t equal to 2 into x of t plus 3, right? So x of t is my input. It acts on 2. It is multiplied by 2, added with 3, and it produces an output y of t, right? I have tried to plot this equation on a graph, right? The response that I got over here is nothing but a straight line. You can see that x axis is my input x of t, y axis is nothing but my output y of t. Right. So plotting this equation, I got the response as a straight line. Right. So any system whose response is a straight line is called as a linear system. Right. A very simple thing. A straight line equation y equal to mx plus c, or any form of equation which follows a straight line. Obviously, next we have gone for one more equation y of t equal to 0.5 x squared of t minus 5. Right. We are trying to plot this onto a graph. It does not give a linear, it gives a parabola, right? So any type of system whose response, what is the response? The output y of t based on the value of input x of t, right? Whose response is non-linear, or whose response is not a straight line, is called as non-linear system, right? Now let us go into how you can, what is the detailed methodology of classifying whether a given system is linear or non-linear. So fundamentally, linear systems obey the principle of superposition. Non-linear systems do not obey the law of superposition. So what is called a principle of superposition, right? Principle of superposition is based on two laws. One is law of additivity and the other one is a law of homogeneity, right? So this superposition principle is what we are going to apply in order to find out whether a given system is linear or not. Right. So first, let us just see what is called as law of additivity. Right. If we are not going into how we are going to check. I'm just going to give you an insight into what is called as law of additivity. So here you can see that what is given here is I have an input x1 of t. Right. Signal x1 of t. It is applied onto a system. The corresponding output that is produced is y1 of t. Right. Similarly, I have another independent input x2 of t. Apply to system 2, the corresponding output is y2 of t, right? Suppose these outputs are summed together and the corresponding output that I am getting is called as y dash of t, right? So this is one aspect. I am just getting the responses, right? y1 and y2 are responses. I am adding those, I am getting what is called as y dash of t, right? Second perspective is, I'm taking both the inputs x1 of 2 and x2 of 2. But before passing it on to a system, I am just adding both the inputs x1 and x2. The resultant x1 and x2 is then passed on to a system, right? I am getting an output y of t, right? So here, these are two, in both cases, we are getting an output, right? In the first case, the responses y1 of t and y2 of t were added, right? Individual responses were added. Whereas here, the inputs were summed and then passed to a system and the corresponding output was obtained. If these two outputs evaluate to the same value, then that system obeys the law of additivity, right? You can just put a pause and just have an insight about it to what is called as additivity. So y of t is equal to y dash of t, it obeys law of additivity. Moving on to law of homogeneity. What is called as law of homogeneity? If x of t is applied to a system and it produces a corresponding output y of t, then if you multiply the input x of t by some scalar quantity or weighted quantity a, right, then if the corresponding output y of t is also multiplied by a, or if this system produces an output which is multiplied by a, then that systems obey the law of homogeneity, right? So the input is multiplied by a, and if the system produces an output which is again multiplied by a, then it obeys the law of homogeneity, right? So principle of superposition takes into account both this law of additivity and law of homogeneity. So we will combine these two in this particular side. So x1 of t is the input. It is applied to, you can just follow with me step by step. x1 of t is my independent input, right? Which is applied to system 1, right? Then we get the corresponding output y1 of t of the system. Then x2 of t is another independent input applied to system 2. We get the output y2 of t. These two, y1 of t is scaled by a, y2 of t is scaled by b in order to bring homogeneous aspect into account, right? So y1 of t is multiplied by a and y2 of t is multiplied by b. What will be the output? A into y1 of t and b into y2 of t. Now we are going to add these two responses. So a y1 of t and b y2 of t are weighted responses or scaled responses, right? Because the responses have been scaled by a factor of a and b. Now adding these two together, we obtained a output which is called as y dash of t. So this y dash of t, I am denoting it as weighted or scaled sum of outputs, right? Because it is weighted or scaled sum of outputs. That is, the outputs y1 of 2 and y2 of 2 are scaled and added together. And that is why y dash of t is called as weighted or scaled sum of outputs. It is one perspective. Let us take the other perspective. We have this input x1 of t and x2 of t. Now, before applying to the system, both these inputs, one is scaled by A, another one is scaled by B, right? After scaling, what you get? You will get here A into x1 of t and you'll be getting here B into x2 of t. These two are added together to produce A x1 of t plus B x2 of t, right? So this added output is passed on to a system, and this system again produces an output y of t. I think you can notice the difference between these two perspectives, right? In the previous case, responses were obtained, scaled and added. But in the second case, inputs were scaled and then added, and then it was passed on to the system, right? So this input, this output y of t is nothing but, this output y of t is output due to weighted or scaled sum of inputs. That is, the output y of t which is obtained due to scaled sum of inputs, right? So now linearity comes into account. So you have to check for y of t and y dash of t, right? If y of t is equal to y dash of t, then the system is called as linear system. If y of t is not equal to y dash of t, it is called as non-linear system, right? So you can put a pause and then analyze or try to understand what is called as or how to check for linearity. We proceed on to the problems. So check for the linearity of the system. So the system equation that is given here is y of t equal to t into x of t, right? So x of t is the input, it is multiplied by t, and the corresponding output is y of t, right? Step one. So how do you, if you follow these steps, it will be easier for you to arrive at a conclusion without any confusion. So step one. Step one is you should find weighted or scale sum of outputs, right? So my step one will be to find this corresponding output y of t, right? So how do I find here y of t? Scaled sum, weighted or scaled sum of outputs. Okay, so here it should actually be the reverse. You can take this as y of t and you can take this as y dash of t. That's it. So here, to find the weighted or scaled sum of outputs, to find this, you can take y of t and you can split it into two responses. I need to find two responses. So one is y1 of t and another is y2 of t. So what you do is, in the system equation, just you find the first outputs, individual outputs. So what will be the individual outputs? Y1 of t equal to, just from this equation, you can write y1 of t equal to t into x1 of t, right? Y2 of t equal to t into x2 of t, right? You have obtained the individual outputs. Now, you have to find the weighted or scaled sum of outputs. So, next is, we are going to find scaled outputs. And then, next one will be summing. So, what will be the scaled output? What is called a scaled? You are going to multiply this equation entirely by A. This equation entirely by B. So, A y1 of t equal to A t x1 of t, B y2 of t equal to B t into x2 of t. Then, so now, next one, y dash of t. So, y dash of t. So, actually here, the only thing that I would like to change here is, this should be y dash of t, right? Okay. So, next third one is, we have found outputs, we have got scaled outputs, but our ultimate aim is to what find? To find weighted or scaled sum of outputs. So, y dash of t equal to A into y1 of t. That is, you have to add A into y1 of t plus B into y2 of t. So, when you substitute from this equation, A y1 of t is A t x1 of t plus B t x2 of t. So, you have obtained a weighted sum of outputs. So, weighted sum of outputs, y dash of t is equal to. So, this equation same, right? Y dash of t equal to at x1 of t plus bt x2 of t. So, this is equation number 1. This equation number 1 is nothing but the previous slide that we have seen. We have just obtained this part, weighted sum of outputs we obtained. So the next part is, we have to obtain output due to weighted or scaled sum of inputs, right? So to find out that, we will proceed on. So step 2, to find output due to weighted or scaled sum of inputs, and that corresponding output is called as y of t. So how do you find this? So your input x of t should be written in terms of x1 and x2, right? So, weighted sum of inputs. So, let x of t is equal to, if you take the previous one, we have seen, we have taken x of t, we have multiplied it with A, we have taken x2 of t, multiplied it with B, and then we have added both together. So, let x of t equal to A into x1 of t plus B into x2 of t. Now, it is passed on to the system. So, what is the system here? This is my system, y of t equal to t into x of t. So in the place of x of t, you have to substitute this, right? So we know that y of t equal to t into x of t. So t into a x1 of t plus b x2 of t. You are getting the equation y of t equal to a t x1 of t plus b t x2 of t. This is equation 2, right? When you compare equation 1 and 2, you can see that both these right hand sides are equal. That is, y of t is equal to y dash of t. So, y dash of t is nothing but what? A into y1 of t plus b into y. The simple thing is y of t equal to y dash of t, right? Hence, the system is called as linear, right? So, this is a procedure to find out if the system is linear or not, right? Moving on to the next problem, check for linearity of the system y of n equal to 2 into x of n plus 1 by x of n minus 1. So, to first step is you have to find output due to weighted or scale sum of output. This is a discrete time system. So, it should be y of n. It's going to be y dash of n. So, first we are going to find weighted or scaled sum of output, which is nothing but y dash of n. So, how do you find? Same procedure. Y of n, you have to split into two outputs, y1 of n, y2 of n. First, you find outputs. Rewrite this equation in terms of y1 and y2. So, y1 and then y2, right? What is the next step? You have to scale it. That means this entire equation you multiply by A. This entire equation you multiply by B. So scaled outputs you are multiplying by A and the next equation you are multiplying by B. What is the third one? You have to find the weighted sum of the scaled outputs. Both these equations you have to add so that you get y dash of n. So weighted sum of outputs y dash of n, right? So it should be y dash of n is equal to a into y1 of n plus b into y2 of n, right? So now in the place of a y1 and b y2, substitute these over here. So when you substitute, what do you get? Y dash of n is equal to y dash of n is equal to 2a into x1 of n plus a by x1 of n minus 1 plus 2b x2 plus b, right? So this is equation number 1, right? Next step 2. What is step 2? You should find output due to weighted or scaled sum of inputs, which is nothing but y of n. So how do you find your input x of n? You should first write it as weighted sum of inputs, x of n equal to a into x1 of n plus b into x2 of n. For clarification, you can go to the slide which was done previously. So we know that y of n. So now what you do? You write your original equation, system equation. And then in the place of x of n, you are going to substitute a into x1 of n plus b into x2 of n. Fine, right? So, you are going to substitute in the place of x of n. But what about x of n minus 1, right? Instead of x of n, you will substitute this. What will you substitute in the place of x of n minus 1? Put a pause and think. X of n minus 1 is nothing but shifted version of x of n, right? So, how do you proceed on with this? Y of n is equal to 2 into a into x1 of n plus b into x2 of n. If x of n is equal to so and so, x of n minus 1 will be equal to what? A into x1 of n minus 1 plus b into x2 of n minus 1. The same thing has been written over here, right? So, this is equation number 2, right? So, comparing these two equations, do you find out that equation 1 and 2 is same? Observe carefully. Comparing equation 1 and 2, y of n is not equal to y dash of n. So, here you can see that the fractions are separate. Here the fraction is together, right? So, this type of equation is called as non-linear system, or this type of system is called as non-linear system, right? Moving on to the next one, check for the linearity of the system. You can see that this is a differential type of equation, right? D into y of t by dt plus 2 into y of t equal to x squared of t. So, y of t itself is in the form of differential form, right? These type of problems, to make it simpler, what we do is we follow this procedure. As usual, step 1, to find scaled or sum of outputs, which is nothing but y dash of t. We need to find what is y dash of t, right? So, outputs So y of t, you have to split into y1 of t and y2 of t. So what we have to do, if you replace this equation, wherever you have y of t, you're going to put as y1. Wherever you are going to have x squared of t, you're going to put it as x1. Similarly, what is the modification you're going to do here for simplicity of calculation is the entire differential equation is there, right, with related to y, right? That differential equation with related to y should be replaced as capital y1 of t, right? So what happens? Capital y1 of t is equal to x1 squared of t. There, capital y1 of t is nothing but dy1 of t by dt plus 2 into y1 of t. Similarly, dy2 of t plus t. So it goes on. So this differential equation is replaced by capital y2 of t. This is just to simplify the process. So now, similarly, find now weighted output. So what will be the weighted outputs? You have to multiply this AY1 of t, AX1 squared. So you will be getting AY1 of t equal to AX1 squared. Similarly, second equation, if you multiply here, Y2 of t, BY2 of t equal to BX2 of square. As usual, you are going to add those. The only difference is, instead of putting small y, you are putting this entire differential equation into a capital Y. That's it. So, a y of t, capital Y of t equal to a into y1 of t plus b into y2 of t. Just substitute this a y1 and by1 from the previous. So, you will be getting an expression y of t equal to ax1 squared of t plus bx2 squared of t. Right? Now, second step. You have to find the output due to weighted or scaled sum of inputs. Right? As usual. So, weighted sum of input x of t is written as a into x1 of t plus b into x2 of t, right? Next one is output due to weighted sum of inputs. So, we know our original equation. So, this was our original equation. This original equation, this can be written as, that is, what we are doing is here, this dy of t by dt plus 2 into y of t, we are replacing it by capital Y of t is equal to what? X squared of t, which is output due to weighted sum of inputs. So it is equal to, in the place of x squared of t, you are going to substitute this, right? X of t is this. So what will be x squared of t? The entire thing whole square. So if you substitute this, you'll be getting this. So, see, it is a plus b the whole square. So, it's a squared plus b squared formula. If you apply, you'll be getting an expression like this. This is equation number 2, right? Compare this equation number 2 with your previous equation number 1. This is actually your equation number 1. Here you have only two terms, right? ax1 squared plus bx2 squared. But you can find out here that you are getting three terms, right? So, if you compare equation 1 and 2, they are not equal. Hence, the system is called as non-linear system, right? So, the takeaway of this particular problem is, when you are given with any differential equation, right, the entire differential equation can be changed into capital Y of t, so that simplification will be easier. That's it. Otherwise, the procedure is...
So this class we have seen discussed about causality property and linearity property for both continuous as well as discrete time system. So please apply your knowledge on to these two problems. Verify causality and then verify linearity for the next one. Next class we will be studying about the remaining properties, time variance, stability and memory property of systems. Thank you.